The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome everyone to our fourth webinar on PCI DSS as per our commitment one every month. Well, it's been a very interesting month for us, and just a couple of weeks back, I was there in Thailand. I was called by the PCI Council to make a presentation on PCI DSS and the cloud. I submitted a paper. It was an honor and a privilege to have been selected to be called. And quite a few of our clients and friends insisted that I take the same topic because they were unable to come there to attend the event. The event was extremely well organized by PCI Council, and my heartfelt gratitude to them for their efforts and calling me in. Well, this webinar is going to be slightly more time consuming than earlier. This will be like 40 minutes long, but I'll try to make it as worthwhile as possible. The topic is too big. I still have to squeeze it in. So stick around. All right, so for the first thing, this is the subject. What we are looking at, PCI DSS in the cloud, parts and solutions. And the topic, I'll be covering quite a few things. The meeting objectives, well, of course, we'll be looking at what the various models are there in the industry and what could be the best possible solution for you. I won't be suggesting to you whether it is Amazon is better or Google is better, but what options that is being available and what could be a best fit for your industry, something that we'll be exploring in this webinar. And we'll be again be looking at what exactly a cloud provider may promise and what you can actually expect. Because remember one thing, I'll keep on repeating this, but remember that the standard for the cloud, even though there are many organizations who have tried to form a benchmark, there are no fixed standards in the industry, and based on the marketing gimmicks of the various cloud providers, they may sell you X, but actually say it's a Y. So we'll get into those two, so pay attention. So last but not the least, we'll also be looking at what could be the audit points if you are a QSA or if you're looking at your solution being audited by a QSA. So these are the meeting objectives. What we'll not be discussing, we'll not be looking into each and every possible risk scenario pertaining to the cloud, because understand, this will take me a couple of days to do this, and I just have 40 minutes now, which again I spent 5 minutes. We cannot possibly cover all the mitigation strategies, because again, that is more relevant to your specific framework, to your business objectives and stuff. So I'll give you the thought process, but you'll have to build up on that, or you can drop me a line and I'll try and help you out. So again, we'll not be looking at the entire cloud risk mitigation control framework, or as I said earlier, answering you which is the best cloud service provider, because again, it depends on what you're signed up for. My reference materials, what I have looked at while making this presentation, the NIST documentation, SP500, ENISA, which has been there for a really long time, research material from CSA. And last but not the least, my primary reference documents has been the PCI DSS cloud guidelines, of which I'm a part of the contributors to the standard. Again, it's been a privilege to be invited to be a part of the special interest group by PCI DSS to contribute to the standard itself. It's very, very interesting. We are hoping to get the standard out by the year end, 2017, so let's hope for the best. All right, just to give you a brief of who I am, so you can put the face to the voice that you're hearing, this is me. I've been there for quite a few years now. I've been working for like 25 years now, and I've got my own company. This is Vista InfoSec. We are a consulting company. So I'm not a cloud provider. I will not be advising you into buying my cloud solution, because we don't have one. We are basically advisors to you. So I don't have an axe to grind. All right, so jumping right into the topic, what is the scene? So typically speaking, you go to your boss, this is what happens in an industry, you go to your boss with a resource requirement that, okay, we need to put in some hard drives, some servers and stuff, and your boss says, okay, go ahead, if you're lucky that is, to buy your new servers, okay, increase your, if you want, increase the software, buy whatever you want, but ensure that we remain PCI compliant. While that's a tall order because technology changes, and to that the geek response, look to the cloud. That is because of the easy way out, and it's the best way that I can suggest. That is, don't get into any sort of do it yourself unless you have very deep pockets and people with you. With the cloud, you just pay for the bandwidth and the server resources that you need, and it is up and running in a few hours. If you get your own things in place, it will take you a few months. So then what happens? The cloud. This is a summation of what has been my experience. I have been speaking on the cloud for a few years now. And if you can try this yourself. Ask five people, what do you mean by the cloud and what do they understand? And you'll see that every one of you will give it their own interpretation of what the cloud is. And that reminded me of the six blind men and the elephant. I'm sure that you must have remembered this story when you were in school. So six blind men exploring an elephant, and each one comes with a different description of what the elephant is all about. So that's what the cloud is all about for most people, because there is, again, no standard, and most people don't intend to get into the research or the development or the study part, and most rely on what the marketing guys have to say. So as per NIST, what is the definition? As per NIST, it's a shared pool of configurable computing resources. But remember, the keyword over here is on demand. So it's a shared pool used by multiple people, and it's on demand. So if you say I need more CPU, more horsepower, more bandwidth, but again, you may say that, oh, I've already was doing that at the IDC, where I can say I need two more servers and stuff. But understand, here it is, you pay as you use. So you can say one CPU, 10 CPUs, 100 CPUs, number of GBs. So it is invoicing as per the provisioning that's happening. In a typical IDC scenario, you are just taking like one rack, or you're looking at 20 servers and stuff like that. So you are basically renting out space in an IDC. But here, you don't have any understanding of what is the underlying infrastructure, where the servers are residing. If they are at one location or 10 locations, you don't know. That's not what happens in a typical IDC scenario. Of course, the cloud is also on the IDC, but the modeling is different. The best example that I can think of over here is like the electric power that happens. Now, as I'm sure that you're aware, the electric company is not really running a wire from its transformers, from where it generates electricity to you. There is just a wire running to the local transformer, and as per your usage, you get billed. So that is how it happens even for the cloud. Now, I'm sure that many of you would be thinking, oh yeah, we are aware of this to some level. Yes, it is. It is just some repackaging of what has already been there for more than a decade. So let's get into more nuances of what the cloud is all about. So, but the question that arises is why cloud computing and why it is catching up so well? Just to be honest with you, in our company, almost everything is there on the cloud. Why? Because we don't want to get into managing servers and backing up and maintaining uptimes and all such stuff. So what we do is just buy, a cloud system. We just pay for the CPU and the memory and the utilization. Typically, it's unlimited. Now, what's the problem with having my own server room? Not just me or any other company for say. Just let's put this in your scenario. Like, you would be setting up your own data center, keeping what in mind? You'll be doing it with, you've got some salesmen or some marketing guys logging on end of the month to raise their vouchers, or it could be somebody from the finance department generating MIS, at which time the utilization of the CPU shoots up. So what you do is that your average could be as low as 20% of capacity, but at specific times of the day or month, it will be shooting up to maybe 60% or 70%. So to accommodate for that additional utilization, which is a spike in utilization, you end up buying an entire horse when you actually don't need the whole thing. You only are using like 20% on an average, but you're still paying for the entire 100%. So that's what Forrester Research and Gartner and IDC have agreed, that is most of our data centers are lying 85% idle, 80 to 85% idle most of the time. But just to take into consideration those spikes, you end up buying much more. Then you have to factor in disaster recovery, then you have to factor in upgrades, then you have to factor in licensing. All such things happen. So that's where the cloud computing, so you pay as you go, you don't need to manage environmental, physical, security, uptimes and stuff, they take care of it. So the question is, how or what is the cloud and how is it managed? So, okay, you don't use balloons to get the data into the cloud. The cloud delivery models, this is just like a generalization, but I hope you get the message on this. There is three primary criterion of delivery. One is private, community, and public. There is a hybrid too, but it's a accumulation of all the other three. In the private, it is a cloud that has been set up just for you. So unless you are a huge Amazon or Google or one of the largest companies in the world, you wouldn't really be having a private cloud. Very few companies do actually have it. It requires tons of money, tons of people, infrastructure uptimes. So that is out of bounds for almost 99% of the companies. So community is where you may say that, okay, there is a cloud which has been set up for the manufacturing. So looking at the cloud requirements or the application of the infrastructure requirements of the manufacturing industry or the pharma industry or the banking, a specific set of applications or platforms have been set up to service a specific industry vertical. That's a community. So somebody can even set up a community PCI DSS cloud, fully certified on PCI DSS for the payment gateways. So that's a community cloud. Public means open to everyone for anything. So your Azure, AWS, all those things are very good examples of the public cloud. Hybrid, of course, as the definition goes, it's a composition of two or more of these deployment models. So primarily what we'll be seeing most of the time is the public clouds, the deployment scenarios. Now pay attention to this. First was the delivery model, now this is the deployment. So the first one, you may have heard of this, that is software as a service. So most of them, like Salesforce, or in your organization you may have taken an HR application or a CRM and stuff like that, that's software as a service. So you're basically paying on a per user or per company basis, or it's basically a licensing model covering a per user or a block of users, that is. The second is platform as a service. In this thing, they don't give you any application, but in platform as a service, they provide you like a Windows platform or a web application or an MSNQ model or a database, and you put your application on top of that. So the service provider, that's a cloud provider, just gives the base operating system or the database or the web server. You build your application on top of it as per your requirement. The next is infrastructure as a service or data center as a service. This is bare metal nuts and bolts. So they'll just give you a bare metal server. You'll just get a command prompt and you install whatever you want, whether it is Linux or Windows or whatever on earth you want to install. Put up your own platforms, put your own applications, put up your own databases, and you manage it. So the cloud provider is just providing you the bare metal systems for you. And of course, there is a fourth category. This is again marketing gimmicks. So I won't dwell into it much, but you'll hear something like security as a service, antivirus as a service, anti-malware as a service, identity access management as a service, compliance as a service. So all these things are marketing gimmicks, but they basically fall into all in the top three that I've shown you earlier. That is again desktop as a service, where it is more of virtual, desktop computing, virtual VDI infrastructure as a service. So all these things start spawning, but again, by and large, it falls in the top three. So I will not get into the other section much. Our entire webinar will now be focused on the top three: software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure as a service. Now, this is the most important slide that you will see. The basic problem that arises, not just in PCI DSS, but in anything that you're doing with the cloud, is who's going to do what? Many a time, the company assigns an SLA and assumes that everything is going to be taken care of by the cloud provider, which is typically not the case. For example, in software as a service, data is a joint. What do you mean by joint? That's where the problem becomes. So the orange slots that you see are the problem areas. So in the orange, for example, the SaaS, who owns the data? Who's going to manage the data? Who's going to take the backups? Who's going to, archive the old data? All those things becomes a question mark. Who's going to do what? Again, the application, the user, the cloud provider may give you controlled access to the application because you don't own the applications. There are a few hundred other companies also using the same application. So what responsibilities lies on you? What responsibilities lies on the service provider? With regards to platform as a service, the same thing. One thing is very clear in platform as a service is the data is 100% responsibility of the client, of you as a client. As you go down, you can see the rate part is dropping in software as a service. Most of the responsibility lies with the cloud service provider, whether it is physical or network or storage or compute power, maintenance lies with the service provider. And as we go to from left to right, you can see that the cloud provider's responsibility drops and your responsibility as a tenant or a client increases. But again, be very clear on this because I've seen, we worked with many cloud providers so far and clients are shifting to the cloud. Take my word for it. It is very well possible that the client is selling you or the service provider is selling you a software as a service SaaS, but he has bundled in many more responsibilities on your head which would typically come under platform as a service. So don't take anything for granted. Look at what the service provider SLA is all about. Go through it, get somebody on board. You can drop me a line. I'll do my best to help you out. You can see my details at the end of the presentation, so don't worry. The biggest challenge in any cloud, you can say that the number one reason for drivers for shifting to the cloud could be performance or availability or licensing scenarios, and the biggest challenges could be if I don't use the cloud, it could be performance issues or availability issues. But the number one issues surrounding the cloud is security. Look at this outcome from an IDC research survey. 88.5% of the people are more concerned about security rather than performance or availability. You would have thought availability would be the number one concern or challenge faced by any client when they're shifting to the cloud. But the number one thing on their mind is security, and there is a reason for that. We'll get into it. Coming to the meat of the presentation, security and the cloud. The upside, let's speak about the good things first. The staff specialization. Understand, now you may be a respectable company with good people on board or a small company, doesn't matter, but setting up your own data center with your own databases, application servers will require to set up a, maybe 5 to 10 people at least in your IT team, just managing your servers, databases, firewalls, networks, uptime and stuff. And then the problem comes, what if some particular person leaves? What about rotation? What about expertise? But understand, if for a cloud provider, this is his bread and butter. You can, you will have difficulty retaining 10 people. You would have a few hundred people. The best of the breed, they can afford to pay their high salaries and keep them busy at the same time. So staff specialization becomes a solid upside for maintaining the security at the cloud if done by the cloud service provider, because they have the best people on board. They can afford to keep them and keep them busy at the same time. The platform strength, since they are having a massive platform, servers, hundreds of servers, automated systems for maintaining the uptime, patching, managing the licenses, special discounts with Microsoft and stuff like that. They have the best of the breed platform in place. Resource availability, again, because of they are having multiple disaster recovery scenarios built into the cloud, uptime doesn't really become a problem. Resource availability, again, because they are having a cloud, they need to have a lot of spare horsepower, bandwidth, storage, and again, because of the on-the-fly provisioning, it is very well possible that over a period of time, that evens out for them. So it is not like they will be maintaining the server uptime with 80% not in use. That's not how it works out for a cloud service provider. Backup and recovery done with automated solutions, uptimes, SSD hard drives, offsite locations, something that most companies cannot even dream of. And they have it because this is their business. This is their bread and butter. Mobile endpoints, this is something that many cloud service providers are providing, that they can not just managing your devices on the cloud, your resources or infrastructure on the cloud, but even the mobile endpoints. Not all of them, but a few of them have started providing for that. What about the key security and privacy issues in that case? What we are looking at understanding? Quite a few. Quite a few. Number one, becoming governance. How is the cloud? It may look very good that, okay, we have 500 people managing the cloud and stuff like that, but how is the governance factor? How are they managing their governing the risk and compliance? What about, okay, let me give you an example of compliance and data location. For example, in India, you cannot have, like not just in India, many other countries also, you cannot take your financial data out of the geographical boundaries of the country. But the very nature of the cloud means that you have no idea where your data resides. It could be in India, it could be in Singapore, it could be in the US, or maybe parts of it residing in the US, some in Africa, some in Singapore. You don't know. So this is something that you may want to look at with your cloud service provider. There could be many other European Union laws, US laws, which look at what data is being stored where and how it's being managed. Insider access. Understand one thing. The people in the backend who are managing the cloud have access to almost everything. You may think that you have your own unique user ID and password, but because they're running the cloud, they're managing the heart of it, there would be ways and means for them to get access to whatever they want, whenever they want. Data ownership, like I've seen these problems happening. You may think that because you've entered the data, it belongs to you. Well, that's not the case. Read your SLA. I've seen SLAs where the cloud service provider has actually put in clauses where if you want to terminate, they'll charge you for letting you get your own data off from the cloud or taking a backup off from the cloud. Can you believe that? But that's the SLA that you sign, you end up paying it. What about composite and nested services? While working on the SIG with the PCI, SSE, PCI Council, this is becoming a very tricky model. It's very well possible that a cloud service, that you have outsourced your infrastructure or platform or software to a cloud provider, and a cloud provider has outsourced part of his services to somebody else. So you may think that you're working with an X provider, but he's got A, B, C, D, E, F, G cloud service providers in the back end. Visibility alerts, who gets alerted for what, who's supposed to be alerted and working on what alerts. Risk management, architecture of the entire cloud, which is something that they'll never agree to. Data discovery, this is something critical. NPCI DSS, CHD, cardholder data discovery. I'm sure you're aware of that. That's a mandatory. But what happens is, think about it. It's very well possible that in the morning, your data resided on some servers in Singapore. Now, because of some issues that is coming up from the part of your cloud service provider's cloud in Singapore, the data got shifted to the servers in London. Now, you are accessing it in a very seamless, transparent manner. Earlier, you were accessing it from Singapore, but now in a seamless manner, transparent manner, unknown to you, you are now accessing the same data based in UK. But when you do a CHD, you are scanning your instance in UK without knowing that the same data is lying dormant on the cloud service provider's servers in Singapore. Data discovery becomes a major issue with PCI DSS and the cloud. Right to audit, very, very few of them will actually give you that. Well, it doesn't end over here, it continues. Virtual network protection. As you're aware, segmentation is extremely important. If you do not segment, the entire infrastructure and the setup comes under the provision of PCI DSS certification. Ancillary data, it could be that by the virtue of how the cloud has been set up, there are potential leakages of confidential information. Client-side protection, server-side, server software isolation. As you're aware, you cannot share your application with somebody else. That's an absolute no-no. With regards to PCI DSS, you cannot share your software instance with any other user. Multi-tenancy is absolutely not allowed in PCI DSS. Data protection, data isolation, sanitization becomes major issues with regards to the cloud. So how do you take care of it? Take care of your roles and responsibilities. What do I mean by that? This is just an illustrative R&R, roles and responsibilities. Okay, don't take this as this is how PCI wants you to do. No, this is just representative. Again, these are the 12 requirements, and I put down over here what is the cloud service provider. So you can see in case of a infrastructure as a service, here it is written as both. So let me take an example of firewall configuration. Who is going to mandate, who's going to control what rules can be put in the firewall or deny it, and how is it going to be kept latest up to date, take a backup of the firewall, maintain the baselines of the firewall. All those things becomes very tricky gray area issues. But the only way out is in the software as a service, where maintaining the firewall configuration and all becomes 100% the responsibility of the cloud service provider. But again, remember that chart that I've shown you earlier with regards to the orange, green and red. This is a representation of that. Security as a service. This is something that I just put in over here because there is a huge misconception. Many people think that because only those areas or those providers who are storing, processing or transmitting your card data becomes a part of the scope. Well, that's not the case. It is part of the case, but not that's not the only case. Understand, any sort of service that you buy which directly or indirectly affects the security of your card data environment, it could be SIEM services, awareness training, SaaS based anti malware, VAPT, whatever services that you may have purchased, becomes a part of your PCI DSS scope, because they directly or indirectly are affecting the security of your PCI DSS. So they are a part of a PCI DSS scope also. Segmentation and scoping. This becomes extremely tricky how you are going to manage. There are do's and don'ts, and after that you'll end up wondering whether are we still talking about a cloud? Yes. So there are some very, very strict do's and don'ts to get around it. Segmentation considerations. Look at this. Must provide an equivalent level of isolation as that achievable through physical network separation. So with regards to the cloud, you don't really have a view of what is happening in the background. So you are not able to understand the segmentation part. But if you are looking at a PCI certified environment, you'll have to ensure that there is an equivalent level of segmentation that the service provider is providing to you. There is guaranteed isolation of data. We'll get into this in detail. No connectivity between client environments at all. You cannot just say that, okay, separate clients are using separate usernames and passwords. It's not acceptable. We'll get into this. Again, shared infrastructure used house and in scope client would be in scope for the client's PCI DSS also. So in short, a shared infrastructure, unless segmented, is a part of the scope. Segmentation tips. This is like almost like a copy paste from PCI DSS. Physical firewalls and network segmentation at the infrastructure level of the cloud. Firewalls at the hypervisor and the VM. Now, most of the time you'll see firewalls only at the VM level, required at the hypervisor level also. VLAN tagging, zoning required, IPS required, DLP tools again required at the hypervisor and the VM levels. It's required to ensure that data is not leaking between different virtual machines. Out of band communication, segmented data stores, strong two-factor authentication. That this is a definite yes, you need to have it in place. Segregation of duties again becomes very tricky how you are going to manage it, because there will be people in the back end who will be managing multiple clients, but you'll have to ensure that the maker and checkers are different even at the cloud level, or they'll have to prove it to you how it is being done. The good. Of course, I'm sure that a few of you must have understood that as Clint Eastwood from A Few Dollars More, one of my favorite movies. Well, what is acceptable in that case with regards to PCI DSS? If it is a traditional ASP, physically separate servers, you don't have any problem. Virtual servers that are individually dedicated is fine. In virtualized servers, in VMs, individually in a cloud, virtually individually dedicated to you is fine. Clients running separate logical partition using separate database management systems, separate partitions even of the application, separate database instances is what is required. And this is something that you need to keep in mind. key management operations isolated from the cloud. So even if there is a hack, the key encryption, decryption parameters are not stored in the cloud itself. So you're not putting all your cloud, all your eggs in one basket. Then what's the bad and the ugly? This is something that you need to keep track of. You can't use the same application image on the same server. Even if it is different servers or different images on the same server, it is not acceptable. You cannot say that they are using a separate user ID and password, like a Salesforce, how it happens. It's not acceptable. And same instance of database, even though data is encrypted, separate user ID passwords, it's not acceptable. Even the database instance has to be separate. Getting the facts in place. Understand, if the CSP is compliant, that your cloud service provider is compliant, does not mean that you are, as a client yourself. Accountability still lies with you. Because CSP is client, so let's assume you go become PCI DSS compliant tomorrow, doesn't mean that your cloud service provider in the backend becomes PCI DSS compliant also. And if the CSP is compliant, some clients are compliant, doesn't mean all the other clients are. So you have to work with your CSP, check their AOC attestation of compliance to check whether whatever services that they are providing or promising to you is a part of the PCI DSS scope. In case the CSP says that they are PCI DSS compliant. I've seen this being thrown quite a few times. They say, don't worry, we are PCI DSS compliant. And then when you actually check what the client is being offered, it doesn't get reflected in totality in the AOC. So take care of that. Questions to ask. How long has the CSP been PCI DSS compliant? CSP is cloud service provider. Where is the last validation? It shouldn't be that the validation happened 2 years back and the PCI DSS certificate has so far expired. What is being included in the validation? What were included in the validation with regards to facilities and system components? What was not included? What is included? What is not included? You need to be very, very clear about that. Now, again, you have to also check how does the CSP ensure that other clients are not introducing non-compliant components into the environment, which can then play around with your own compliance. It's very well possible that somebody else's idiocy affects your compliance. So what do you expect from compliant, that is PCI DSS compliant? The one thing I always say, demand evidence. Think critically. Worst case scenario, I always say in that case, the cloud service provider should be treated as guilty until proven innocent. I know it doesn't sound good, but that's how it's supposed to be. A proof of compliance, ask for the AOC. You are within your rights to ask for the AOC. Documented evidence for system components that are included. Ask them for the evidence, what was included and what was excluded from the AOC. Very important for you. What if your cloud service provider was not PCI DSS compliant? Keep calm. I know it is very difficult. In my opinion, you shouldn't go ahead with it. But in case you do decide to take the plunge, go through everything. Go through everything. Systems, facilities, personnel, go and visit over there. Check their policies, procedures, documentation, system baseline, training records, incident response plans. Everything. Assume that they are getting PCI DSS compliant themselves. What would be the evidence? In my opinion, get a QSA to even audit them. Just from the compliance, not the certification perspective. To end, let me quote Paul Maritz, who was the CEO of VMware, and see what he has to say. Public cloud providers must take data loss liability. If I turn that around, what that literally means is that if you are there on the cloud, most of the public cloud providers won't take any responsibility in case your data gets compromised. That is something that you need to think about. Well, that brings me to the end of my presentation. I really hope it made sense to you. If you have any queries, please do send it in. I'll be more than happy to respond to you. That's my email address. And our YouTube page is there for you to visit in case you would like to see the earlier webinars that we had for us put up online on our YouTube page. Thank you again, and I'll see you again next month. I guess I'll be covering at that time PCI DSS and the wireless environment, top risk and mitigations. So I look forward to seeing you then. Thank you again for being such a wonderful audience. Thank you. Bye-bye.